الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم. Man is the best creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the creative process and on top of that, then the soft changes that he brought into him, they are even more tremendous. When we talk of the soft changes, then ultimately we are in fact referring to software. Software and hardware. You know, this body is a hardware, and in this body Allah Almighty has installed that software that we were talking about earlier on. You know that no matter how beautiful, sophisticated is your software, but if your hardware doesn't support your software, you cannot achieve good results. So Allah Almighty first created man best of all to have its hardware the best of all, and then the best software was installed into it.
Created virus.
Then another important thing is, all human beings are not alike. Some are strong, some are weak. So a strong man will operate this software strongly, and a weak man will operate this software weakly. Simple principle. Now at the hardware also, Allah Almighty started a software installing in the living beings right from the plants, and that was in the form of chromosomes. What are chromosomes? Have you ever thought of them? Chromosomes are the software of living beings. They are not visible by the naked eyes, not even visible by the ordinary microscopes. How sophisticated are they? Only with the electron microscope you can see them. But those small thread of RNA, DNA control the whole body. Right? Different animals have got different numbers of chromosomes. Man has how many? 46 in the form of 23 pairs. Then among the human beings and among the animals and even the plants, Allah Almighty has differentiated between the male and female. Each and every cell of male is different from that of female, or you can say each and every cell of female is different from that of male. Now when, you know, this software actually is the hardware for that sophisticated software. If you don't understand this point, then you cannot understand the guidance of the Quran. Why Allah Almighty sent different ahkam for men and women? You know, we studied in secularism that the claim of secularism is that belief that laws and education should be based on facts and science, etc., rather than religion. They go on this principle everywhere, but when they come to man and woman, they forget this principle and they shout and shout and shout, man and woman are identical. Whereas they are not identical. When each and every cell of man is different from woman, and the difference is 1 by 46. 45 chromosomes are identical, and one chromosome is different. But how many cells are there in a human body?
46. Hmm? 46.
Not millions, not billions, trillions. So, 1 by 46 multiplied by trillions, what would be the result? Ask some mathematician, he may be able to calculate, or statistician, at least I can't calculate. But if you don't understand this point, every now and then while reading the Quran, while reading fiqh, while reading hadith, you may or may not speak out, but you will certainly have some point that, oh, there's a discrimination. Isn't it so? You are a good Muslim and you accept Allah's commands. Fine. But in the corner of your heart, there will be a concern. Oh, this is not fair. This is not fair. This is not fair. But if you understand that these are two entirely different creatures, they are not identical. Forget about it, who is great and who is small. That is another issue. Allah Almighty, at the mother and father level, made the mother supreme. At the husband and wife life, husband and wife level, He has made the husband supreme. But everywhere you'll find difference. Prayer different, Hajj different, Zakat different, Psalm different. But everywhere you'll find different account. When you don't understand this, there'll be two possibilities. Number one, you may rebel against Islam. Oh, it's discriminative. The question is Islam discriminative, or man and woman are by nature, by creation different? When they are different, okay, if you are that strong, just change the nature of man and woman, and by genetic engineering, make this difference equal and let man and woman both have the same type of chromosomes. But if you change this, would this life continue? Because the difference of man and woman is towards the reproduction. You know, man in himself is complete, woman in herself is complete. You know, there are mostly assigned duties, that these are the jobs of women and these are the jobs of men. But at least living in America, you know, women can do everything, but man does. And men, even if they didn't do there, they do everything but women do. One thing, they can't help each other, and that is reproduction. This system of creation is dependent on reproduction. If reproduction stops, humanity ends. If you want humanity to continue, then you have to have reproduction. And reproduction is only dependent upon this differentiation of the two sexes. So, number one, you cannot change it, and if you change it, that will be the end of the history. What I mean to say is that when you start reading the Quran, number one, what we have already studied, you should be clear that what's the difference between plants, physical objects, animals, and man. There's a beautiful shair from Iqbal, Taqdeer ke paaband nabatat o jamadat. Nabatat means plants, jamadat means physical objects. Physical objects and the plants are tied up with the taqdeer. What do you call taqdeer in English? Fate. Yeah. Mumin faqat Allah ke ahkam ka paband. But man is free. No, yesterday we concluded that man is free. What is restriction on man? That he has to comply with the commands of Allah. Allah Almighty has made him free and asked him to obey me with your own will. That's the difference. Since animals were not free, they had no choice. When an animal cannot control its instincts, it's useless to say, don't eat, don't drink, restrict eating, restrict drinking, restrict this, restrict that. It's a funny demand from it. So man, Allah Almighty demands man to comply with his commands. First, he has been duly equipped to do so. So why plants are not given by Allah commands? Why not animals have been given commands? Only man, because he is independent and free. Now, what's guidance? Have you ever thought about it? What is guidance?
Show the way.
Very good. When you ask someone to guide you, what would you say to him?
Right path.
Which right path? You were in the morning looking for Walmart, and you ask someone, where is it? Had you just asked him, please guide me, please guide me, please guide me, please guide me, would he have been able to guide you? No.
No, he'll just tell us this. Where you going this way or this way? He'll just tell you
the. No. The question is, the guidance is always according to the destination. You are guided according to your destination. If you want to go to Walmart and somebody is guiding to another store which you don't want, will you accept his guidance? No. So guidance is always according to the destination. If you have to seek guidance from someone, you have to tell him what you are looking for, what you are heading to. Only then he will be able to guide you. And if brother Azar prepares the sheets, guidance for the participants of the camp when they leave, and he prepares a map how to go to the Canadian border. Yes, Brother Ishaq and Brother Sultan may be happy to receive that paper so that they don't go here and there and they directly hit their target. But for all others, is it of any use? It's not of any use. Now come to the Quran. We say Quran is a guidance for us. Which road map Quran is showing us? Heading to what?
Jannah.
Are we looking for Jannah?
No.
Tell me honestly.
No.
So is Quran guidance for us?
Yes.
How?
It's our fault that we are not practicing.
The question is not a fault or not. The question is, you are not in pursuit of paradise and somebody is giving you, oh, Brother Sultan, this is the way to paradise. Will you accept the paper from him?
No. It's just a guidance unless you practice or act upon it.
But how will you act upon? You are not convinced. You are not convinced that it will take you to your target.
That's a different story.
No.
So this is the story.
We don't want to go to camp.
What do you say?
Guys, tell you
why you may want to go over to the place to give the reason, the purpose to want to go somewhere.
But until Allah, I am convinced that this is the guidance for me, I'm not going to accept it. I have to be convinced. You are not looking for that destination which you are being guided for. Why should you get that paper? Why should you read that paper? Why should you follow that paper? To waste your time?
Depends upon a degree of your iman.
Forget about iman for the time being. We are talking about guidance.
Guidance depending upon degree of iman. But you are looking for that. That's the main thing. Is it a worldly thing, guidance, or eternal guidance?
No, the issue is, what's my destination? We are being a Muslim. We claim, okay. We
accept it. But how much we accept it, you know it.
Problem is, even with us, what is my goal?
If you're not satisfied, if you're not feeling comfortable, don't want to be where you are, and you want to go someplace else, and someone give you his different type of answers to tell you, or possibilities as to where you could go.
And if you have a clue that, okay, this way also we can head to our destination, yes, you may follow that route. But if you are not convinced that going this way, you will reach your destination, you will never ever take that way. Be honest to yourself. So?
Isn't it guidance that convince you?
But that guidance, you know, the examples I gave you first, you agreed with those examples?
Yes.
That the map are the directions Brother Azhar have composed and made copies of, they are of Canadian border. But there are only two candidates of Canadian borders. What about the rest?
Maybe in the future? I said
no, maybe there are another highway.
We are all after dunya. Be honest. Aren't we? But Quran is asking us to look for paradise. So is Quran for us or someone else? But since as Muslims we believe there is a guidance for us. You know, as I said, this class is to understand Islam to your level of understanding. Now let's prove that Quran is guidance for us. We are all after dunya. But what is our goal in dunya?
The Quran is a whole complete guidance in this world. And
answer my question. What is our goal in dunya?
To live according to the guidance of Islam.
You know, a person who came here in 1978, right? He worked, made a lot of money. And when he thought that, yes, he has made an achievement, what did he do?
Retire. Then he will start worshipping Allah.
Depends on what kind of person you are talking about.
He bought a house. Wasn't he?
Yeah.
No. He bought a house. Why?
To enjoy his life.
Why? There are many other ways to enjoy life. Why house?
Maybe his ambition was there. His goal was there. Because everyone has his own goal set, okay?
No. Everyone has got this goal. You know, a businessman, when he thinks that he has established his business, what he will do? He will build a mansion.
Sir, it's as you said, according to our understanding level, right?
Right.
So, I was coming here, my goal was, even I found a place in a masjid, that's the best way for me when I don't get any place to live here in USA. Look, my goal is not so higher. Someone may be coming here and he's not going to live in a masjid. His goal is to live in a hotel or motel, wherever you are.
Mm-hmm.
So, I am content here. someone is not content here, someone's contentment is in other things.
No, I'll take it, you take you as exception. Exception proves the rule. House, why? What comfort? First of all, if he is living in a rented house, he always has something in his mind, he has to pay rent. Then he always thinks the landlord may not ask him to turn out of the house, to get out of the house, vacate the house. And then he will have to look for another house. Oh. Or the house previously he is living in, he lacks facilities. So he looks for a spacious house. Right? More facilitated house. And what is special in the space? What is in the spacious house other than which you don't have in the apartment?
Location.
And
lots of things we cannot bring in a smaller home or in a rental house.
No, in an apartment,
backyard.
You don't have a backyard. And when you have just a backyard, you feel, oh, you should have a front yard too. And then there should be
covered garage,
and there should be a greenery here, greenery there, and there should be some water also flowing below, underneath. This is what Allah also is inviting you to. You know, the house that you buy here and you like to have here, assuming that this will be your permanent residence, that is not your permanent residence. You ultimately will be turned out of that house, sooner or later.
If you don't pay rent.
You are lagging behind. We are much ahead of it. Israel will also come, right? Israel will also come, alayhi salam.
We are living now in our home.
With a warrant in his hand from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Get out!
That's what I'm saying, that depending on how you believe, what are your belief, which is goal of life, depends upon your belief. If you are raised, somebody, anyone is a really Muslim and God fearing Muslim, his goal is eternal.
But we don't have an internal goal. We are Muslims, yet we don't have that eternal goal. We are looking for the houses.
What is Jannah?
What Allah Almighty is inviting us to? To a very spacious house surrounded by the gardens.
What is the place to have a place in Jannah? It is eternal.
That is eternal. But the thing is, our level, our pursuit is not Jannah. Our pursuit is a house. Allah Almighty invites us to a better house and a permanent house, which you will never be turned out of. It will be surrounded by the gardens, underneath which rivers will flow. You want to have a seaside, or a lakeside, or a riverside.
Allah does not encourage you to have always a good house.
This is what Allah Almighty is asking you to. Yes, brother.
What I am understanding, if we say rather than our target or our we are pursuing for home, basically we are pursuing for the dunya. When I am pursuing for dunya, it includes definitely all what I need. Maybe I need a home, car, all of my worldly life requirement. Is it better than the house or what?
The fact is, don't bring belief in. The fact is, what are my pursuits?
Yeah.
On ground, my pursuits are good house.
No. Yeah. Good job.
Good job.
I disagree.
Car. And a young wife. No, be honest.
No, it was. Now it's
all. No. It is yet. Only because in love, because in car, ko nahi karna. And all this has been promised with you, that you work for Allah, You know, your employer also says, okay, you work for me, I'll give you this, I'll give you car, I'll give you residence, I'll provide you this, I'll provide you this. Medical will be
free.
Insured.
Yeah.
Right? This and that. Allah Almighty is saying the same. You work for me, I'll give you the house of your choice.
But where?
Even more than that.
Where?
Wherever.
Not in this world.
No, not in this world.
Not necessarily.
Not in this world.
Yeah.
Ultimately, somewhere. That is basically not my concern.
Jannat al-Firdaus or Jannat is not here.
I don't know if it's here or there, but it's in Allah. Not this world.
Yeah.
Certainly. Allah Almighty is promising with me a house of my choice with all the luxuries, which include وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ. There you will have all you desire. وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَدَّعُونَ. Moreover, in addition, whatever you ask for will be provided. This is the house which Allah Almighty is promising. And in this world also, I am looking for it. So, the Quran is guide for me. Because it is telling me how to achieve the goal. You are looking for a house? Yes, I have a house for you. You are looking for the young women to be around? Yes, I have for you. You want to have springs around you? Yes, I have for you. All you desire is there. You cannot have such a house here in this world. So Quran is a guide for us. Another question. When we open up the Quran, we don't find any guidance in it. What to do?
Don't find any guidance?
When we open up the Quran, we don't find directions in it. Do this, do this, do this, do this. You know, you read this, you read that chart. IONA has listed all what you have to do when you come here. When you open up the Quran, you don't see the list of do this, 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 this. First of all, there is a description of ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ الْعَرَبِيَ فِي هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And that's it. And then the other thing starts. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَنْذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنْذِرُهُمْ. So Allah Almighty is showing me to do kufr also. Then there is a discussion of munafiqeen. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. So what's for me there? Am I a munafiq?
Well, rightly. Quran has broadly, you know, outlined that this should be your goal if you have full iman. And then they have showed the past stories of those who did not obey Allah's commandment.
Okay, I go the other way around. Leave it here. What type of book is this? Zalikal Kitabu.
Book of guidance.
How was the mode of guidance? Is it a textbook?
Throughout the worldly life, how should you spend?
I'm saying there's no list of what to do.
There is a list there.
Quran is not to tell you all what you have to do. Hadith has also to come.
Quran and Hadith combined has brought you.
I'm talking about the Quran. First, cut talk of the Quran. Yes.
If I had seen a book like that, I'm not understanding what's in it. I would ask somebody.
You know, my question is, when I open the book, I don't find what to do.
I will ask somebody.
You have to learn Arabic.
I will ask somebody to help me.
So you will be able to draw all what you have to do from the Quran after learning Arabic? I don't think so.
Our prophet, in his last sermon, what he said?
You need that.
Quran says, I am self-sufficient for guidance.
No. Prophet Muhammad says, if you stick to Quran and my Sunnah, which is Hadith, you won't get astray.
Says,
okay. You get everything, whatever.
But I'm talking about the Quran. Quran says it is Al-HUDA, the guidance.
You're taking half of this guidance book.
I'm not negating that.
So why are you taking only Quran? Why not Hadith?
hadith, as far as the ahkam are concerned, what to do and what not to do, Quran is not sufficient.
Hadith is the practical
book of... Not only hadith. There are four sources of ahkam. Quran, Sunnah, Ijma, and Qiyas.
Ijma comes a lot later on.
But you cannot draw the ahkam without the consensus, ijma, without qiyas.
We have to look first what Prophet has done.
No, I think we should speak with Quran. We are now, you are also jumping the gun, so come back to Quran. Because this will open the new door. If you go to the qiyas.
Nahid kholenge door. Door.
Yes. But one by one, I think. One.
We are sticking to the Quran. I am saying stick to the Quran for the time being. Quran, we claim that it is full guidance, full guidance.
But to understand Quran, you have to...
You don't have to understand the full Quran, yet it is guidance.
You have to get this help of...
Have faith and trust in it.
No, okay, I asked you the question, is it a textbook?
No.
Okay.
It's a book of guidance.
It is a textbook? Is it a book of stories?
It's a unique book.
But how to draw guidance from the Quran? My question is there. It is not a textbook. It doesn't resemble a textbook. In the textbook, what is described in the first chapter is not described in the third or fourth chapter. Simply reference is given. But here, Musa al-Islam stories is spread throughout the Holy Quran.
Is it how to draw guidance? Through the help of hadith.
No. For ahkam, you will go to the hadith.
Everything.
It's...
From A to Z.
No. Okay. Okay, that means from Quran and hadith. And you know hadith. And to know Quran, hadith and fiqh, everything. You have to leave everything and do that. You cannot do that. So it is only for the ulama to read the Quran?
Why not?
For us. What is for us? Pardon? What is for us? Is Quran guidance for me and you or only for ulama? They will draw the ahkam in the light of hadith and then they will tell us?
For all human beings, Quran is the only book of guidance in this world.
But how?
Whether Muslim or non-Muslim.
How to get? Muttaqeen, how will get? They will get the guidance from the Quran?
To have iman, faith.
There is no chapter of Salat in the Quran. There is no chapter of Zakat in the Quran. There is no chapter of Hajj in the Quran. There is no chapter of Jihad in the Quran.
You said that yes, we want to drive one ahkam or the other thing. We have to see the life of Prophet sallallahu alaihi
wasallam. Of course.
Because whatever was...
But my belief is Quran is self-sufficient in terms of guidance.
If you say, for example, there are people, those who take the faith values. So we say them, they are the denial of the hadith.
No. As far as ahkam is concerned, hadith, ijma and qiyas.
Let me complete.
Yes, sir.
Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, La raiba fi, there is no doubt in it.
Yeah. I have no doubt.
This is a book that there is no doubt in it.
Okay.
In the book, it tells you about Allah found out himself. He gives you descriptions of who he is, and he is the author of the book.
And
it's a very successful session, mashallah. Everybody's involved. My question is still there. I know very little from Arabic. Right? How can I get guidance from the Quran? Or even if I know Arabic and translation of the Quran, then how can I get, what is the list of the pages, that which paper, which page should I study first and which page should I study later? Huh?
You can. There's no list. How? And if I don't know Arabic, how will I?
So, you agree with me?
I agree with you.
Yes, look, I have got one man to support me.
No, Quran says, if you don't...
I'm not alone now. Samim is with me.
You are alone. You are alone.
I have one question. Are you asking this question to test our level of iman, degree of iman?
No, I have nothing to do with iman.
So, why you are asking this question?
Just to make you understand that Quran is the guidance for you.
You are saying one is not guidance.
Then the answer is in your question that you are saying to understand.
But I have to prove that too. You know, first I started that Quran is telling the way to paradise. Yeah. Right? And we are after dunya, you agreed with me. So to start with, we came to a conclusion that we are after dunya and Quran is for akhirah. So apparently it's not a guidance for us. Then we agreed upon that yes, it's a guidance.
Each scenario is different. We supported you. At that time we supported you because you...
Inshallah, again you will support me.
That's not a support. You said, if you don't know the Arabic, yes, we don't know the Arabic. But Allah says, فَسَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ. The people, those who know.
So okay.
Doesn't stop.
Again, you answered my question. Yeah. That then if you have to go the Ahlu Zikr, yes. Then what I can draw from the Quran? My question is...
No, if you want a, okay, you want a particular answer, that's a different thing.
We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. So guide us with us. We make a book. We ask Allah subhanahu
wa ta'ala. Okay. Let me answer my question. The guidance of the Quran is wrapped in its recitation throughout the Quran. The guidance of the Quran is in the recitation of the Quran, starts from Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen and go to Minal Jinnati Wan Nas. Then start from here and go there. Start from here and go there. Inshallah, you will get guidance.
My son is 7-year-old. He's Hafiz. He doesn't understand. How you say that when you start reciting that you will understand? I was Hafiz. I didn't learn Arabic. I don't know what the...
You should not be having a decision that you will not understand.
All of us have some part of Quran memorized. All of us, we are sitting here. Do we understand all the verses? Because
you should try to understand as much as you can.
That's a different thing.
But you cannot understand the whole Quran.
Meditation can make us understand.
But you cannot understand the whole Quran never ever in life.
Yeah, this is the point. This is what
but,
I'm saying.
But you yet, are if but you but if you keep on reciting the Quran regularly in pursuit of guidance through unknown channels, Allah Almighty will guide you.
Adding new phrases. Now, teacher, you are adding new phrases.
So, how do you know that whoever is reciting the Quran daily is in pursuit of guidance?
Yes, he should be in pursuit of guidance. Then he has believed that this is a guidance for him.
Should be something else, but there's thousands of Hafiz who get caught in stealing and...
They don't read Quran in pursuit of guidance.
That is a different issue. I mean, let it be here.
No, Saeed is walking on out on protest.
All those who are Hafiz is not definitely there.
You are walking out on protest?
Yeah.
You are walking out on protest? Yes, brother.
Yes, question.
Just a comment. One aspect of the Quran is it talks about. This is one aspect of it. It talks about stories.
So don't be scared, brother. Don't be scared. Ask whatever you mean.
It talks about stories. It talks about people come before you. In particular, it talks about the messengers and prophets. So perhaps people would reflect on what has come before them. That's one aspect. I mean, there's two laws in there.
Okay, actually, the thing is, Allah Almighty has revealed the Quran, who is our Creator. He knows all my needs, physical needs and spiritual needs. How many times should I be reminded of the hereafter? No one knows better than Allah. So, in this guidance, a prescription of guidance, He has included the reference of the hereafter that many times. And you open up from anywhere in the Quran, in any text, read from here to there. I don't find you find any page in the Quran in which Akhirah is not mentioned this way or the other. So anyone who recites Quran regularly, look how regularly he will be reminded about the hereafter. And simply, if I remind that I have to die and then be raised to life again and appear before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for my accountability, tell me, can I go wrong?
No. Yes, you can go wrong. Whosoever is reading Quran daily, is not definitely is a good Muslim.
If I am reminded about the hereafter and then I receive the reminder. We all forget, but more and more we remember Akhirah, more likely we are going to be on the right track. Number two, I give you, most of the Quran comprises of stories. Right? I give you example of one story. And one that story of Adam alayhi salam and Iblis. Quran has described this story after regular intervals. In Juz 1, plus 7, Juz 8, plus 6, Juz 14, then 15, 16, and then plus 7, Juz 23, and then plus 8 will be again Juz 1. This story is a lesson for us. We are human beings, and none of us, as long as we are not messengers and prophets, none of us can ever be perfect, mind you. It's an assumption that there can be an absolutely pious man. To me, as I read from the Quran, there can be no absolutely pious man. He has to commit mistakes every now and then. What's the lesson of the story of Adam and Iblis? Iblis disobeyed Allah. And so did Adam and Eve, alayhi salam. And both were called for explanation. Satan was arrogant and he blamed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your command was wrong. Reconsider your command. You created me from fire and you created him from dust. He is inferior to me. I was not supposed to prostrate in front of him. So your command was wrong. I was right. And Adam and Eve could also say, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Iblis has told us that you have created us for earth and one way or the other you have to send us to the earth. Okay, send us. Instead, what they did? رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. This is the lesson. I, as a human being, have to make mistakes and blunders. But guidance is ask forgiveness, repent, whatever you have done.
But how you get guidance?
This is the guidance.
Through the book.
No, one is the ahkam.
The book and through hadith. What our past paramars and sahaba.
Again, you are mixing up two things. Ahkam, I will draw from hadith. But direction, you know, translate guidance as direction. My direction will be straight if I read Quran regularly and get lesson from it. No matter I am making mistake, but I'll be making mistake in the right direction. But if I leave Quran,
reading Quran and get lesson from this Quran or Hadith is not sufficient unless you practice it. Practice makes a man perfect.
Right? I say none of us can be perfect.
No, I'm not discussing this thing.
You can be perfect?
No.
So we have to make mistakes.
I just can put one more. Let me tell one thing and I'll stop it.
It's very hard for you to stop.
One Sahaba asked Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, I pray with most khushu and khudu, but how do I know that my prayers are being accepted by Allah, or to what extent or what degree it is accepted? So see, this is the way of Prophet used to teach their Sahaba. This whole, I myself don't know these things, but I can tell you one, tell you one yardstick, that if you keep on assessing, using that yardsticks, you'll certainly know that where you stay 1 year from now.
But my dear brother, let me tell you, hadith is not something which is to be recited again and again. And it is such a huge treasure that even the big muhaddiseen have not gone through all the hadith.
This hadith is one.
No. But the question is, who will decide that read this hadith and don't read this hadith?
You have not yet.
But Quran is an open book to every Muslim. He has to recite from the beginning till the end. And on every page you will get the guidance.
We read Quran with context.
And let me tell you, no matter how conscious, what is the conscious level of yours, you cannot recite with full concentration.
Right.
You got to lose concentration. But if you recite for half an hour and for few seconds only you get concentration, even that is sufficient for you. I'll give you an example how Quran guides. You know, once there was a problem in the college when I was a student. And even at that time, alhamdulillah, my teacher be blessed, who actually taught me that whenever you are upset, revert to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he will solve your problem. And recite from the Quran. So I came to the hostel and I started reading the Quran. I read Arabic in the 6th to 8th class, so I could understand 60% of the Quran without translation. But while reciting, you are not fully attentive. I just turned over the page and I assumed that, oh, as if one word was missing from recitation, I came back. The ayah was, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَكِيلًا. Trust in Allah. Allah is sufficient to solve the problem. I said, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, the matter is solved.
Depending first.
That is the real guidance. When you have such a guidance from the Quran, it appears to you that this ayah has just now revealed to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your guidance.
But this is the hukam. You said the hukam is only a hadith.
No.
Lots of hukam in Quran directly you can understand.
The,
you go to the hadith.
You know, one of the sources, first source is Quran, second source is Sunnah, not hadith. Sunnah.
Yeah.
Third source is Ijma and fourth source is Qiyas.
Then make 5, 6, that's not a big
then
deal.
You deduce from the hadith, not on there's no third source, only two sources, Quran and hadith, that's it. And from there you deduce the other things that
are. But for guidance, for direction, to set you in the right direction, Quran is sufficient.
No.
It is.
No.
So we differ to we agree to differ. Okay. We agree to differ. Yes, miss. You said you not speak. After that, you are again speaking.
You have not heard my.
I already said you can't stop yourself.
Stop me in the middle of that.
Yes, it.
What's the first ladder in the Quran? What's so, the first ladder?
First?
First ladder from the Quran when you open.
It's my Bismillah Bakalah.
No. The first ladder when you open the Quran.
Alhamdulillah.
No, the first ladder. You start with Bismillah, right?
B.
B. Good. It's Ba, right?
There's a difference of opinion on that.
When you open the Quran, right? Just listen.
There's a difference of opinion that Bismillah is just written there or it is a part of Quran. So the question is that Quran actually, if you recite Quran regularly, Quran in a very subtle way keeps you on the track. If you are on track, no matter, you make mistakes and you repent. But if you are detracked, very important is dalalat is to get detracked. Then no matter how pious are you acting, you are wrong. Because you may become arrogant. And it takes no time that you become self-centered. And Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, there are three things which kill you. Salatun, muhlikatun. And the third was, ijabul mar'i bi nafsihi. Someone's feeling that he is the best of all. Right? And it takes no time to make you feel that you are the best. Whatever. If you are a righteous person, you are more likely to feel that you are the best. But if you are in between, then you are more likely to feel, oh Allah, please forgive me. More pious you are, hardly you will ask Allah to forgive you. And this is the astray. The guidance is that go side by side. On one hand, you have the fear of Allah. And on other hand, you have the expectation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He will forgive you. Bain al khawfi wa raja. As Rasulullah said.
So when he compared from Akbar and I also put only one.
Okay.
Since in the given
tier.
I disagree with him at this year.
You disagree?
Yes.
Then it means you disagree with Akbar.
Yes. I cannot disagree with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. With everyone else, I can disagree.
Please try to understand.
So, when you are reading, the stories in the Quran, come to the story of Nuh alayhi salam. Nuh alayhi salam did dawa for how many years? 950 years plus. Right? No, normally we think that, one of our friends in Faisalabad, he says that Islam is matloob, not talib. So we should not go after people too much. A few times we should ask them to come to the right path. If they don't, we should not go after them again and again. But you have this opinion in your mind, and then you are reading the Quran, and then from Nuh al-Islam story, you realize, no, there was no one to listen to him. Yet for 950 years, he was saying, giving the same message again and again and again and again. Then, Nuh alayhi salam, the leaders of the clan, they said, oh no, we like to listen to you, your sermon is very nice, but our kamis, our slaves, they have a better position in you. First turn them out, then we will come. Now, living in Toronto, you cannot understand this. If you go to a tribal society, or a village of Punjab or Sindh or of NWFP, Pakistan, or Balochistan, then you realize what is this story. Lord is Lord and slave is slave. This is the guidance of the Quran. Then if you are simply delivering a sermon, be righteous and don't be unchaste, be modest, people will kiss your hands and pay you respect. But there is a nightclub going to be established in your neighborhood, and you go there and say, I won't allow this. I assure you, you will have to listen what Lut alayhi salam had to listen. Aj akhrijuhum min qaryatikum innahum unasun yatatahharun. Turn them out of your town. They are pious people. Right? So this guidance you can get from the Quran only. When you read Quran again and again, and you are going through certain situation, Allah will manage to click you at that very point, and that will be the real guidance for you. And Quran is always open for you for such guidance. And these are the life-changing points when they click you. They are the real guidance. Yes, brother.
Okay, you're right. Absolutely right. So, Quran says, you told us, وَرَضِيْتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ مَدِينَةً وَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي. It means our deen is perfect, complete, right? So you are giving us example of Pakistan or the other places. Okay, maybe I am from there, maybe I have traveled, so I can understand. But I'm living in Toronto and living in the US.
No.
How I can understand?
No. It's not necessary for each and every ayat.
Try to understand. Your examples are excellent. You are right. But please be here in North America. Because Quran is for all of us. Right?
Okay. Okay, come to North America. Come to North America. Okay. I am.
These guys who are not going to back home.
No.
I can make them understand.
I am saying the one who has that experience and then reads Quran. He doesn't have that experience, and there's no guidance for him from the Quran, from that ayah of the Quran. Okay. But he has some other ayahs, many other ayahs, which I may not have even. For example, you are a pious man. You are doing a dawah work. And Shaitan will seduce you that, okay, you are now a pious man. Doesn't happen if you mix with sisters for the sake of Islam. But if you read Quran and Surah Yusuf you are reading, inshallah, it will click to you that no one is above this. Wama ubarriu nafsi. If Yusuf alayhi salam says that, I am not above this. Inna nafsala maratus misu. How can I assume?
So my next question is, as we are now living
and
here,
not only that,
mixing here with the sister, is it right? According to you,
it is always dangerous. I have to keep in mind. If I am the reader of the Quran,
we have the same such mixing, and we have in this type of class, there should be a differentiation between us.
Yes, should be. I believe.
So why not?
That's not up to him, though.
It's not my arrangement.
You are a teacher. You want to give lecture. You want to give lecture. You want to teach us Arabic. You teach Arabic. You want to change your khutbah. You can change.
In Quran Academy, Faisalabad, we only give video link.
That's it. Here also people they are teaching on the video or other things.
It's better. But I believe it's better.
We are here to learn, right? We are here to learn.
But the
we
question is, if only 29 seconds.
In such a way, I'm going to teach in the same way. So what I'm conveying.
So it's always dangerous. It is always dangerous.
Don't say it's always dangerous. Try to develop such an environment here. At least try.
No, no. In 1 week, I can't develop an environment. Yes, where I have control, alhamdulillah, I do that.